Well, a few months later, again the Fellows Ranch House in suburban Long Island. Harry Fellows is in the open kitchen dining area in his bathrobe, happily making breakfast for Karen and Chrissy. The ladies, however, are not down yet, and Harry is having a time of his life banging pots and pans and making his special blueberry pancake recipe. Harry is singing "Volare" loudly and badly, substituting a la-la whenever he doesn't know the words, which is often. The ladies of the house are still not coming to admire him at work, so he calls out,
"Volare, la-la-la-la." Oh, ladies, ladies, where are you? Rise and shine, you swabbies, all hands on deck. Can't you smell the coffee and my patented world-famous Harry Fellows blueberry pancakes?
No response.
Come on, they're gonna get cold.
No response.
Hey, Chrissy, Karen, breakfast is ready.
No response. Now Harry is a bit annoyed. He leaves the kitchen and goes to the stairs to shout up,
"Hello? Hello, Chrissy? Karen?"
The sound of a door opening and a toilet flushing, Chrissy shouts from off stage.
Am I Chrissy? Okay.
No, I. Which is which? Karen is the daughter.
Who's the daughter?
Oh, okay, you're Chrissy.
Right.
Again.
Yeah.
Right.
Coming, honey. I was in the bathroom.
Placated, Harry goes back to his pots and pans. A moment later, Chrissy comes in a robe, no makeup, brushing her hair. As Harry is a regular-looking suburban American guy, Chrissy is a regular-looking suburban American housewife. Both are attractive people, a good, happy couple. On the young side of middle age, affectionate with each other.
Good morning, hon.
Good morning, sweetie. You sleep well?
How could I not?
Meaning that they had made love the night before. Had a successfully.
Me too.
They kiss. Harry pulls her close and gives Chrissy's rear end a squeeze. She slaps his hand away, a loving couple's byplay. Chrissy smells the pancakes.
Ooh, Harold Fellows, international famous fresh blueberry pancakes, I see.
With the maple syrup we brought back from New Hampshire.
From Rosley, that wonderful farmer's market up the hill from our bed and breakfast.
Chrissy reaches to take a bite. Harry pushes her hand away.
Not until our little princess deigns to grace us with her presence.
I'll give her a shout.
Chrissy goes to the stairs, ready to shout.
We wouldn't wake her this morning. Remember she said last night, "Now look, Mom and Dad, I don't want you shouting at me to get up anymore because..."
Because in one week, I'm turning 16, and 16-year-olds aren't babies, and they don't have to be told when to get out of bed on a Saturday morning.
Not a baby anymore? Ridiculous.
Don't say it's ridiculous to her, Harry.
Well, it is. She is still a baby. Our baby.
Fine, fine. Tell me that. Just don't tell her. I mean it.
All right. Okay.
Seriously, it could ruin her big day.
Oh, puff, puff.
Harry, I'm not kidding.
So where is this tender little grown-up that we've immersed in our bosom?
She has her door closed, and when I knock, she screams, "Don't you dare come in!"
Well, give her a shout now. The waffles will be getting cold.
Chrissy goes to the stairs and shouts up,
"Honey, honey, time for breakfast. Dad's made his delicious waffles."
Karen's voice comes from off stage.
"Okay, here I come. Are you ready?"
Chrissy and Harry say together,
"We're ready."
"Are you really ready?"
We're really ready.
Really ready with whipped cream on top?
Oh, Jesus.
Shh. "Yes, dear. We're ready with whipped cream on top."
Karen's still on stage.
"And now, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, clamoring crowds of well-wishers from around the world, are you ready to meet the most talented, beautiful, and delightfully sophisticated woman in the world, Princess Karen Elizabeth Fellows?"
In one big bound, Karen is in the room.
Ta-da!
Karen trips and falls awkwardly, but even more noteworthy in her outfit a ghastly conglomeration of long looping necklaces, huge sparkling earrings, sunglasses, high heels, black lace tights, combs in her tangled hair, sloppy lipstick smeared on sparkly eyeshadow, bright red rouge, a foot-long cigarette holder, and beneath it all, a purple bikini bathing suit that does little to hide her abundant adolescent figure. Chrissy and Harry stare in horror and disbelief. What has Karen been thinking of? Does she think this is cute, funny? Can she possibly think she's dressed like a grown-up? Harry can't help it, but he laughs. Chrissy shoots him a dirty look. He tries to stop. Chrissy goes to Karen and helps her get up. Karen pushes her away. She doesn't need any help. Chrissy doesn't know what to say.
Karen, honey.
Karen imitates her idea of a sophisticated woman's voice.
Darling, darling, so good to see you. Isn't it fun to be here on the Riviera before the summer mobs ruin everything? God, the great unwashed.
What the hell?
Father, dear, don't be too upset. Don't be upset. No, no, no. It's far too lovely a day.
Karen takes a puff of her cigarette and breaks into a violent...
Chrissy, do something. Do something.
Is that smoke I'm smelling? Something burning, perhaps?
Smoke is billowing out of the grill. Harry jumps to rescue the latest batch, but he's too late. The pancakes are a blackened mess.
Well, we can't eat that now, can we? Try again, Daddy dear. Be a good boy, too.
Harry is getting seriously annoyed.
Come on now. She's your daughter.
I think you had some role in the matter. But look, Karen, honey, this is going a little far. Now look, run back upstairs and put on something more sensible.
Sensible? Sensible? How horribly plebeian of you, darling. Common sense is for common people, don't you think?
Karen, you'll go to your bathroom this instant and take off all that junk.
Junk?
Yes, junk. And put on ordinary clothes right now, young lady.
My dear sir. Junk, you say? How you dare call my splendid and splendidly original outfit junk?
Because it is junk. You look horrible. Now go change your clothes, and I'll make fresh pancakes to make up for the burned ones, and we'll have a nice family breakfast.
Karen is on the verge of tears. Horribly. Really hurt, but she tries to keep her act going.
Well, if that's the way you feel about my original ensemble, my dear papa. I would take that to indicate that you did not go to Paris this year for Fashion Week.
No, I did not. I was hard at work keeping a roof over your head, young lady, and so was your mother.
Chrissy tries to pull things off.
Well, we can certainly say it's original.
Originally horrible.
Must you keep using that vulgar word, father, dear?
Discussion time is finished. Done. Karen, go upstairs and change into an outfit with some semblance of normality.
I will not. I like my outfit. It's very, very...
Karen searches for the right word.
Outré. That's what it is. Outré. And I like it. I'm going to wear it all day today, no matter what you say.
Oh, no, you don't, young lady. You are going to do what I say, or the whole Sweet 16 party next Saturday? Going to be called off.
Chrissy and Karen look at him as if he were insane.
Harry, what are you saying? We can't cancel the party a week before. The invitations went out ages ago.
We can cancel the party. Just call everybody up and say, Karen is sick, and the party is canceled.
You wouldn't dare, Dad. You wouldn't dare. I'd never speak to you again as long as I live.
If you want that stupid party to go on, you go upstairs and get out of that insane outfit.
Now, come on, you two. Let's cool off a bit.
I'm perfectly cool. Upstairs, young lady. Upstairs, right now.
I hate you. I hate you like I never hated anyone before in my life.
Upstairs. Upstairs.
Harry advances on Karen as if he was going to grab her arm.
Don't you touch me. Don't you dare touch me.
Harry, stop right now. Stop.
You go up and change your clothes, and I won't have to touch you.
Okay, I'll take off this outfit.
Karen starts to rip off all of her necklaces and scarves and veils. Chrissy thinks she might possibly strip naked. She speaks soothingly.
All right, that's enough. That's enough, you two. Karen, go upstairs and start changing. I'll be up in a minute.
I'm going, but not because of anything you two say, because I want to.
Karen stomps out of the room.
Good God, Christ almighty.
Then he notices that the new batch of pancakes have run too.
Jesus, what is happening around here?
Were you going to strike her? Were you?
No, I wasn't going to strike her.
That's good, because if you had, I'd divorce you right away.
I didn't hit her.
Good for you that you didn't.
Silence falls. Harry's still angry but defeated. Goes to the stove and sink and starts to wash off the burnt pancakes again. Chrissy starts to pick up Karen's discarded outfit.
So, where did all that come from?
You don't see her when she comes home from school every day.
Is she like this?
Not exactly.
Not exactly?
Well, all I can say is it wasn't a complete surprise.
It was completely nuts.
No, it wasn't. So you didn't shout and scream at your parents when you were 16?
I never dressed up in rags, faked an English accent, and paraded it around like the Queen of Romania.
Now, that's something I'd pay good money to see.
They were silent for a few minutes. Chrissy needling the discarded clothes. Harry's cleaning up the ruined breakfast. They start to calm down. Harry laughs.
God, this is the sight of her.
Chrissy imitates Karen's upper-crusted accent.
Oh, God, how horribly plebeian of you.
What does plebeian mean, anyway?
I don't know, but it couldn't be as bad as horrible.
I wish I hadn't said that.
At least you didn't hit her.
God, I was tempted.
That must never, ever happen.
Yeah, I know.
More silence. Then comes the sound of Karen coming downstairs. Harry and Chrissy hear it, share a look, but don't say a word. Karen enters, now in ordinary jeans and a blouse, still upset, but keeping herself under control.
Mom, could you please leave the room, please? I want to have a talk with Dad.
You want me to leave?
Yes, I want to talk with Dad, just the two of us.
Chrissy looks at Harry. He shrugs.
Okay, if I hear raised voices, I'm coming back. Do you both understand?
Karen and Harry both nod assent.
I mean it. Let me hear you say so.
We won't raise our voices, promise.
Harry?
Harry can't quite say the words. Chrissy speaks more sternly.
Harry?
Okay. Promise.
With a final warning look, Chrissy leaves and goes upstairs. Silence. Harry waits for Karen to speak. She stands a bit nervous but determined.
Dad?
Yes, Karen.
First, I want to apologize. I don't hate you, and I'm sorry I said I did.
I understand. That's okay.
It wasn't okay. You know I love you.
I love you too. You know I do.
Wait a minute. Now is my time to talk and your time to listen.
Okay. I'm listening.
I want you to apologize for saying I looked horrible.
Well, hold on a sec. You have to admit, you looked pretty odd.
But pretty odd is a long way from horrible.
Not such a long way. Look, you come down the stairs all junked up like that.
Karen rolls up with tears.
There you go again, saying that everything I'm doing is ugly and stupid. Am I really so horrible? I am your daughter, after all.
But that doesn't mean you can't do anything you please. This is our house, after all, and your mother and I work hard to pay the bills and put the food on the table.
That still doesn't mean you can call me names and say everything I say is stupid.
I never called you stupid.
Horrible, stupid, what's the difference?
The difference is that horrible is about how you look. Stupid is what you are inside.
So I'm stupid inside?
Oh, Jesus. I meant you are not stupid inside. inside. You are very smart, young lady. Brilliant, really. So smart, you scare me a little.
Karen likes this.
Thank you.
But look, if we're going to have a heart-to-heart, let's be honest.
So now I'm dishonest?
Now you're putting words in my mouth?
Then I won't say another word.
Silence falls and stretches out for a long moment. Harry busts himself doing the dishes. Karen slowly starts to tear up, and suddenly she bursts out crying and burying her face in her hands. Harry doesn't know what to do at first, and then he approaches her tenderly, putting his hands on her shoulders. Karen collapses in his arms, howling her tears. Chrissy comes down and stares silently and starts to come to them, but Harry waves her off to go back upstairs. Karen starts to lift her head, and Chrissy darts upstairs out of sight.
Sweetie. What's wrong? Everything's all right. I'm sorry if I was rough on you. You know how much I love you.
Karen does start to calm down.
I know, Dad.
I'll never call you horrible again.
That's not what I'm crying about.
Then what is it then?
Oh, sometimes everything seems so awful.
Like what? Like something in school?
No, it shakes her
head. Is it a boy, maybe?
Karen starts to cry again. Harry knows the problem is a boy.
There's a boy you like? Really like?
Karen shrugs. Maybe it is a boy, but it is something more. She lifts her head slightly.
Daddy? Am I ugly?
Ugly? You ugly? You must be joking. Look at me.
Karen barely lifts her head an inch.
No, look at me.
She lifts her head a bit more for a second, and she glances at Harry's face.
Karen Elizabeth Flowers, you are an exceptionally good-looking girl. Wait a sec. An exceptionally attractive young woman.
That's not how it feels to me. My chin is all mushed in. My eyes are too close together. And my eyebrows are so thick.
Stop talking about my daughter like that. I mean it.
And I've hardly started to develop. And most of the other girls have developed. They look all grown up. I could tell because of the way the boys look at them and not at me. The boys think I'm still a sixth grader, a baby.
Look. This is getting beyond what I can talk about. Let's call your mother to this.
Karen shakes her head vigorously. She still wants to talk to her daddy. Harry laughs.
And what's with you calling me daddy? You haven't called me daddy for years.
Oh, it hasn't been that long.
Karen is calmer. Harry senses that and he gently untangles Karen.
You can call me daddy if you really want. If you want. Really. I like it. I like being your daddy. I've always loved being your dad. Now, what's this all about? You coming down, all...
Harry searches for the word that Karen won't mind.
Fancied up. What's bothering my favorite girl?
Oh, I don't know. I just feel so awful sometimes, awkward, and then I think nobody could ever like someone so stupid, so out of it as me.
You? Awkward? Stupid?
Oh, you know what I mean. I mean, I feel awkward and everything. Like at school on Friday between classes, I was carrying my books, and they got caught up in my sweater, and I tried to straighten them, but then I dropped my pen and tried to catch it. My biology book slipped, and then I tried to catch that, and then I lost my balance, and all the books fell, and then I fell down, and a whole bunch of kids went by, popular kids, and they saw it all happen, and they laughed at me.
I am sure they were not laughing at you.
Oh, yes, they were. And this girl, Barbara, bitchy Barbara Harriman, she was walking beside Steve.
Steve?
St- Steve Sussman. He's a boy in our class.
Okay, I just hadn't heard his name before.
Oh, Dad, I talk about him all the time.
Fine, fine. Steve it is.
If you start teasing me about Steve, Dad, I'll...
Okay, okay.
So, bitchy Barbara laughed in this oh-so-superior way and said, oh, some people just can't keep it together. And Steve and the other kids laughed, and I got so angry. By the time I picked myself up and my books up, they had moved down the hall, and I just stood there like an idiot with tears in my eyes, blushing, furious, but with no one to be furious at. I mean, you know what I mean? Seriously, if I had had a gun, I would have killed somebody.
Oh, sweetie, I'm sorry. But, you know, things like that happen to everybody. And me, for instance, just last week, we had a big meeting. All the department heads. I came in late, rushing, coffee in my hands, too hot. I tried to put it down on the conference table. It spilled. And then I dropped a whole pile of papers. I was scrambling to pick them up, and Mr. Armstrong at the head of the table said in his bored, sarcastic voice, "Anytime you're ready, Mr. Fellows."
Oh, Dad, you must have wanted to sink through the floor.
Either that or tell the pompous blank hole to go blank himself.
Dad.
Oh, I'm sorry to speak that way, but that's the truth. That's how I felt.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
For a long moment, Karen and Harry are both silent, thinking over their mutual admissions of weakness.
I guess stupid stuff you get upset with can happen to anybody.
It sure can.
But it always feels like no one in the whole history of the world, the universe, ever felt as bad as me. Like my whole life is ruined for good.
I know what you mean. But that feeling goes away, doesn't it? Like in that meeting, I felt like an idiot mopping up the spilled coffee. But a few minutes later, when I gave my report on marketing trends, Mr. Armstrong, he said, "Good work, fellows," and whoosh! My black mood lifted.
Yeah, I know. I'm the same way.
Silence again. The mood is much more relaxed. Chrissy comes from downstairs, or goes downstairs and pokes her head out.
Testing, testing. Hurricane winds seem to have lessened to a gentle rainfall. May I come in? Pretty please?
Sure you can, Mom. I just needed some dad and daughter time.
Karen runs over to her mother and gives her a big hug. And Karen looks at Harry. Will she hug him? Harry can sense her tension. She feels it too. But they want to do something that says the fight is over. They hug awkwardly and then go and stand so the kitchen table is between them. Harry starts making his third attempt at pancakes. Mm.
All grew peaceful again, once again in the Happy Valley.
The three say it again. It's clearly an old family ritual.
All grew peaceful again,
once again
in
the
Happy Valley.
Orange juice, anyone?
Harry and Karen hold up their glasses. Chrissy fills them. Again, quiet. Karen breaks the silence.
Now, I know what you're going to say. We've told you a million times, but...
Harry and Chrissy burst out laughing. Harry imitates Karen as a child.
Tell me how you two met. When we were six, that was the only way I could get you to sleep.
No, I don't mean that old story about the dance at Cousin Eddie's wedding and how Daddy, well, how he was just Harry, then got you a glass of champagne and then spilled it on your dress.
Stop.
I don't want that old baby story. I mean, I'm old enough to know something of what you really went through, what you felt, what you thought. What I mean is, how did you fall in love? What was it like? Were you scared? Did you have any idea that 17 years later, we'd be here in this house, just the three of us? Me now starting to get close to what you were like then? Come on, tell me.
Harry and Chrissy look at each other. They don't know what to say.
You start.
Well, I thought he was very handsome.
In his tuxedo. Come on, that's the old story.
Well, your mother had just broken up with a guy. It had been very painful.
How painful, Mom?
I thought my heart was broken forever.
This guy was a real a-hole.
Dad, was he, Mom?
Well, if the truth be told, yes, he was an a-hole.
He was mean, stupid too. Always starting those bitter fights.
He'd start this stuff like saying he knew I really looked down on him because his family was poorer than mine, when I was too young to care about money.
On our first dates, your mother would get so upset, acting like I was him, taking it all out on me. Finally, one night, we left the movies because we felt too miserable to enjoy it.
What movie?
Oh, God, I don't know.
I remember. It was The Sound of Music.
Well, that's appropriate.
Oh, yes. And I thought we'd never be a big, soppy, happy family like in the movie.
And I finally got so mad, I started shouting, "Screw him! Screw that guy! He doesn't love you. I love you." And I got up, marched out of the theater, and your mother followed me.
I did not follow you. I was pushing to get ahead of you. I was furious and embarrassed in front of all the people saying, "Shh, shh, we're trying to watch the movie." And Julie Andrews is singing with a big, happy face.
And we got out on the sidewalk. It was freezing. It's Thanksgiving weekend.
The week after Thanksgiving.
How could it have been? I'd have been back in college.
No, because...
God, you two, look, I don't care which weekend it was. Get to the heart of the story.
So we started arguing on the sidewalk, and it was crowded with people. That's how I knew it was Thanksgiving Saturday.
Who cares? What happened?
So I started shouting, "Look, Chrissy, if you just wake up and see what a jerk he is, you know that I love you. I love you with my whole heart and soul. You are the only woman in the world for me."
And of course, I started crying right there on the sidewalk, and he put his arms around me and said, "Shh, shh, darling." And he picked me up and swirled me around, and all the people around started cheering. And at that moment, I looked into your father's eyes, and I knew this was a good guy. And he really loved me. And we could be happy together for the rest of our lives.
With a few bumps and spills along the way.
Nothing so bad.
But a few of those bad times felt awfully bad at the time, just like we were saying, Karen.
Sure. I know what you mean.
Then you come along. Oh, what a thrill that was. The sweetest, dearest baby girl.
When I was nursing you, I felt such a glow of total happiness, you sucking away like a little puppy.
This is getting a little too much.
Okay, too much information.
You asked for it.
I know, but that's enough for now.
Silence gathers again, and then Karen breaks her silence.
Why didn't you have more children? And now I need the real grown-up reason.
This is hard for us to talk about, dear.
We did have a baby, well, almost.
A boy. The doctors called it a miscarriage, but it was very late, and what they had to do meant I couldn't have any more children of our own.
And you never told me?
There wasn't so much to tell, dear. We didn't know what to do.
How old was I?
Only 2 and a half.
So by the time we could have told you, the whole thing had sort of disappeared out of our lives. I mean, not really. We never forgot, but I guess we pushed it to the back of our minds. Tried to, anyway.
So slowly gave away the things we had bought. Clothes and toys.
The room that's now your dad's home office, that was going to be his bedroom.
Was the baby a boy or a girl?
Oh, a boy. Oh, how I dreamed of raising you two together.
I'd already gotten the kid a baseball glove.
We were going to call him Johnny, after your dad's brother.
Come on, Johnny, let's play ball. Come on. Ah, good catch.
Oh, gee.
Karen is moved beyond words. So are Harry and Chris, Chrissy, each feeling the presence of the little boy who never got a chance. They sit in motionless silence. Karen is the first to get up. She goes to the kitchen, gets the orange juice, and pours three glasses, then one extra small glass.
Okay, okay. Your attention, please.
Chrissy and Harry watch her, not knowing what she's going to say or do. Karen gives the glasses to Harry and Chrissy, then puts the little glass down on the counter.
I want to propose a toast to two of the finest, dearest, bravest, sweetest mom and dads any daughter ever had. Hip, hip, hooray!
All three raise their glasses and drink. Harry has his arm around Chrissy, who is openly weeping.
And this little glass is for the fourth member of this beautiful family, Johnny Fellows.
Johnny Theodore Fellows.
Theodora means gift of God.
John Theodore Fellows, who unfortunately can't be here because I just got word that he just hit a home run that won the game for Lakeville Team Baseball League. Way to go, Johnny.
Go, Johnny, go! Johnny, go!
Again, the three are silent, then they gradually grow out of it. Harry is the first to come back to normal. He turns back to the pancakes and his son calls out.
Okay, ladies and gents, ladies and gent, if you can call me a gent, wink, wink.
Harry makes a Groucho Marx face using a spoon as a cigar.
It's time for Harold Fellow's internationally famous fresh blueberry pancakes.
Hooray!
Harry lifts his head after a few big bites.
Ah, the master has not lost his touch.
Better than ever, hon.
The super delicious flipping, flapping, flapping, flapping best pancakes in the history of pancakes.
They all go back to eating. Chrissy returns to ordinary life.
Remember, you've got to get to the dressmaker's Tuesday, 4 o'clock sharp for those alterations.
I know. I already told Mr. Goldman I can't be at band practice.
Did he make a fuss?
Oh, just something about you can't trust teenage girls. But he was only kidding.
Well, I wouldn't have missed this breakfast for anything.
Me too. Our little family.
Oh, Daddy, no more baby talk.
Family, family, family.
Stop that right now.
Family, family.
Oh, if that's the way you're going to be about it, if that's how you're going to be that way about it.
Karen picks up a pile of clothes and necklaces and scarves, wraps herself in them, and starts to take on the affected language and manner she came in with.
Darlings, darlings, it has been just too to be believed. You are so sweet, but alas, our heavenly little hour, like all good things, must come to an end. Is that my car coming back? Ah, yes. No car purrs like a Rolls-Royce purrs, and no one drives more smoothly than Thomas. Ta-da, ta-da, off I go. That mad whirl of it all. The Lyman Forbes are expecting me, and it doesn't do to snub the Lyman Forbes and their 40 millions. When will we meet again? Let's not even try to plan, mes amis. Or should I say au revoir? Oh, I'm sorry, I'm skipping a line. Let's not even try to plan. Let's let life flow as it will flow. Parting is such sweet sorrow. Adieu, adieu, mes amis. Or should I say au revoir, au revoir? God, I never could keep them straight. Ciao, ciao, bambini, ciao.
Pam sweeps up the stairs and disappears. Harry and Chrissy look at each other, dumbfounded. Then they laugh. Can't stop.
No car pearls like a Rolls Royce. Where did she get that stuff?
God only knows.
God only knows.
Michael, you can't kill her off now. It's not fair.
I know, I'm thinking the same thing.
She is so such a delightful.
Okay, Michael, come on up.
Thank you. Wonderful readers, you did just a super job, including the stage direction.
I thought you had done such an absolutely wonderful job of portraying the conflicts between an adolescent teenager and parents. It brought back so many memories of when I was a teenager and my parents, and once again, when my son went through the same phase.
He wore bees and makeup?
Well, wore other things.
He didn't do it.
It's true that in the next play I have it that she's killed in a car accident. But the difficulty is that I know that I have created this woman and people won't want her to die.
Right.
But to get that reaction is part of what I was hoping for. And I thought it would be hard to have her not die because, this is what I figured, that you go to a play or a movie to see something happen. I mean, not much happens for most people on most days. You just live your life and you just have your dinner and breakfast and all that stuff. But then a play is usually about the day that the Titanic does sink. I felt it would be she had to live, but then they had she had to die. So
it's amazing because when we read Karen Come Home, it was just two parents worried about the child. They didn't have. We did not know the depth of the relationship.
Yeah.
We didn't understand how loving the family was. It was just two parents sitting there saying, "Oh well, listen, you should bring home here by now. We called the police. What's going on? Called your friends." But that following this is going to bring huge emotion from the audience because now we will know who these people are.
The couple has lost two children.
Yes.
So could this be first and the other one's a flashback and then you can...
Yeah.
I'm working a bit on the third one to see if I can possibly find a solution. One of which would be to bring her back, like, as an Our Town, the girl comes back and sees life going on. I've been trying that, but haven't gotten very far yet.
We'll play with it.
Yeah.
I've forgotten how old she was when she died in the car accident.
Well, I'm sort of trying to assign. I mean, one thing, I said that it's taking place in the mid 80s because I haven't quite know what to do with cell phones. This is a whole thing, you know.
Right.
Didn't you say that she's like a week away from 16 or something?
Yeah. Well, no, that was
the first play. I'm thinking of her as a little bit younger, maybe 14 or 15, 7th, 8th, 9th grade.
In this one?
In the first one, when she basically spends the afternoon with her mother. Then there's this one. When she's about to turn 16.
Yes.
And then the other one, but now a year or two later, she's like 17. She's going out on dates and stuff. But I have.
She's driving, right?
What?
She's driving.
Steve might have picked her up.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, you know, I like that character, Steve Sussman. That was really. You don't know why I'm saying that.
Can I say something?
Yeah, sure.
There's a lot of silences in the piece, and I think that's so real in everyday life, like you said, people don't have as much to say, but in real life, there is that But he's making this pancake, and then there's, and sometimes maybe they don't know what to say to each other moment, or, oh my God, what's happening to our daughter? I felt so many other things were coming out due to the silence. The thought of, oh gosh, I'm, what the inner mind, but oh God, I'm calling her horrible. I don't need to call her horrible. I felt that because of the silence, because you had to think, let me think of some other kind of thing to say to her. But the silence is a very important piece to this, to, I felt it anyway. Mm-hmm. People trying to figure out how to make every day the same day, you know, keep it going, making it original when we are living the same over and over, which is nice too, but you know, that feeling.
One small thing, waffles, pancakes.
Yes, I
know. Yeah, 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 yeah.
They turn into waffles and then they go back
to pancakes.
So just, I was going to tell you actually when I read it, but I forgot.
Oh, yeah, good. Yeah, okay.
And when you talked about, when they talked about their son, the miscarriage.
Right, they already said it was a boy, and then she said it wasn't a boy. Yeah. But they already, you already said it was a boy.
Yes.
That she asked if it was a boy when they already said it was a boy.
Right.
Was it deliberate? Did you want to make it seem like she wasn't listening, or
did you already say it was a boy?
Yes,
they
do
say it was a little boy. Yeah.
Yeah,
and then
I
she,
just...
And honestly, that would work, because she might be, you know, shocked that, and listening, but not totally listening. Maybe I thought maybe that's what
you do mention it twice.
Yeah.
It's on the same page.
I think I would say that's a mistake.
Yeah.
You know? It's funny when you're writing this stuff, you know, what's the person gonna say? Well, you just write what they're gonna say, you know, she's wearing sneakers, or you know, it's nutty how you can completely make it up. I mean, as you guys
know.
Oh,
sure.
Except when you cook, you know the difference between waffles and pancakes. Be doing both. You got your waffle iron for some, pancakes for the other.
Having a card room.
I just wanted to say that from an actor's point of view, the part that I played had depth. I felt like I could move through. Like a lot of times, one act, short things like this are very one-dimensional, and this really had some. There was some shifts in the daughter, the mother, and so. Acting point of view, it allows you to show another side as the person is actually shifting. That's not so easy to do.
Yeah, and you allowed him to be a real jerk.
Right.
You know, as a dad, you know,
which is
what's
the way
the
fathers are when they feel.
You know. Right, but then the tenderness came out.
Right.
You know, because you were criticizing her, a young girl coming out, being a girl, and then you were able to make that shift. That was really...
You know, I was, maybe it was just me. I was hung up on that for a while. And,
I was too.
And
I didn't like it. I was mad at it.
Well, here's what... I'm thinking to myself, I don't have kids, but it's a big deal. So unless I miss something with the outfit. So she comes down. I thought she was just playing a goof.
Yeah.
And he's making a big issue. Just, it's not a piercing. It's not tattoos. It's something she's goofing around.
No, but this is a budding adolescent in a bikini.
Well,
and that's her father.
Well, that's why.
Underneath it all.
Right, but the whole other thing, I was like, what's he making such an issue out of that she's... I don't know, I was like hung up on that for a long time, and I mean, I realized it was a poignant story, and there's more to it, I get all that, but until you got to that, it just seemed the reason that got him to that whole tenderness, it just seemed, why did he get so, I don't know, for me,
That's very normal.
Huh?
That's very normal.
And especially as your baby girl, fathers have this.
And
it's taken part in the 80s, so just think that they were together 70s, 60s, where she's coming down. She kind of reminds me of something in the 60s. You know, now they wear short skirts. You would like, but they do it anyway. You know what I mean?
It's a father.
I think
it's a father relationship.
She was actually going out in public.
I mean, she was doing that one to act out because of what happened to her at school, apparently, right? Was she doing it?
No, she's just a 16-year-old girl.
Okay, so
never had one.
So, but therefore, right? So, if she's just a 16-year-old girl, he's grown up with her. He knows that. So, I don't know why he got so bent out of shape. I don't get that.
It's his 16-year-old.
She was
16.
But wouldn't he have known she was just goofing around?
Not necessarily.
No.
Maybe this was her new look.
No, I don't know.
I think it's just the recognition of the sexual being that's there.
Yeah.
And it makes fathers very uncomfortable.
Yeah, I mean, the bikini porn, I wouldn't get that.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Well, yeah, and it came across, obviously. Yes. Yes. Yeah.
We have a daughter, and I get stupidly angry numerous times.
Of course.
Yes.
But one thing I want to say is that just watching it go, I was moved by it.
Yeah.
So,
absolutely.
It's a moving
piece.
Yeah.
It is.
Yeah.
But I
want
that.
Yeah, Judy and Akiva did a great job. They were really terrific.
Yeah, excellent. Super. That's really amazing.
I've never seen a paper before.
I mean, you're following your nose through this, where you've never been. I mean, really.
Yes, but you write very well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah,
it was very nice.
Yeah, I can't tell you how I've been looking forward to this, and I. Joanne said, you know, make sure I get a script into her on time. I like this. I like this very, very much.
Well, we like you.